in Parashat Beshalach. Baruch Hashem, we left Mitzrayim yesterday. At least on paper we did. We left Mitzrayim, we left Egypt after a whole orchestra, after a whole a big event of all the plagues and the miracles and everything that's happening. And then finally we go out of Mitzrayim and we find the first big argument in history. And this argument went down in history for many, many, many generations. What is this argument? The story is that the last three parashot, we went to Mitzrayim before that, if you remember the story with Yaakov. After a while, a new king comes up, puts the sons of Yaakov, Bnei Israel, in slavery. They become slaves for 210 years, severe slavery in 86 years. Finally, the Redeemer comes, Moshe Rabbeinu comes, and he does a lot of miracles and gets them finally out of Mitzrayim. Two parashot we spent about talking about all the miracles, about all the plagues. And now, finally, we go out of the Mitzrayim, and we start the parasha by saying that Hashem took us out of Mitzrayim, and amazingly, and we'll find out techev why, instead of going north into towards Sinai to get the Torah, we go south. And we go south for 3 days in the desert through a land that is called the land of Plishtim. And I mean, one of the reasons Hashem did that, because he was afraid that if we go directly into Sinai, right away we're going to see that there's going to approach a war. So he says, okay, let me take them around so they're not going to realize right away there's going to be a war. But nevertheless, we'll talk about later why specifically they went south and not north. But after 3 days, they make a U-turn and Hashem takes them to the worst place in the desert, where it's a corner and there's nothing much to do. There's the ocean in the front and there are two barriers on the left and the right. They can't go anywhere and they're kind of stuck in a corner. And that was already the time when Paro and his army is getting closer and they're stuck. There's nowhere to go. Now comes the famous argument. The nation gets split into four groups. One group says, okay, Paro is coming, there's nothing much to do, let's commit suicide, jump in the water. Anything but not to go back to Mitzrayim. Let's jump into the water. The next group says, no, we're not killing ourselves. Better to be alive and a slave than to be dead and free. Then you're not so free. So the second group says, no, let's make a U-turn. We'll give up, we surrender, let's go back to Mitzrayim. The third group says, you think we're out of Mitzrayim, we're giving up? Let's wage war. Let's go against them. We're a lot of people. We can get into war. They had a lot of weapons with them because they already went out of Mitzrayim with weapons because they knew there's going to be wars down the line. The third group says, no, let's fight. And the fourth group was the very Hasidic. And they said, let's just pray to Hashem. Hashem will save us. Hashem save us up to now. Let's just pray. And of course, Moshe is standing in front of them. And he doesn't know what to do. They're splitting into four groups. So in order to understand this argument, we also have to understand why we needed the miracle of the splitting of the sea. Didn't we just see 10 miracles? We actually saw much more than 10 miracles. We just went through a whole year. I mean, for us, it was 2 parashot, 2 weeks. But all the plagues took a whole year. We spoke about it last week. That 3 months it took for Moshe Rabbeinu from the first time he came till he left. Sorry, from the first time he came and he left till to come back. And then the other 9 months were all the plagues. It was exactly a year. So wasn't it enough? We need another miracle. So we have to understand also why Hashem split the sea. That's also a big question. What, you already proved your supernatural powers. We don't need another one. Just take us straight into the desert. Now, comes of course another question. Why would Hashem so to say, take them 3 days in the desert and then making a U-turn to lead them in a place that they're going to get stuck. What's behind it? I mean, nothing happens for no reason. Hashem doesn't make mistakes. It doesn't just happen to be like, oops, you know, the GPS didn't work. This is a godly GPS. And why would Hashem do that? Take them 3 days in the desert, lead them, and then bring them into a point when they're completely stuck. And that was pretty scary. Just imagine, they're finally getting out of Mitzrayim, and now they're stuck. The water's on one side, the Egyptians on the other side. So we have to understand all these questions, and especially what is the idea of the splitting of the sea. Because up until today, we spoke about it on Shabbat, you know, the miracle of Mitzrayim is the miracle of all history. Up until today, every day we mention the leaving of Egypt. In our tefillin every day, the parshiot of the Shema are in the tefillin talking about leaving Egypt. The mezuzah on our door. We do kiddush on Shabbat. The Ten Commandments. Ten Commandments, just think of it. We get the Ten Commandments. The first commandment says, Anochi hava elokecha, I am your God, asher hotziticha me'eretz Mitzrayim, that I took you out of Egypt. I would think it would be more appropriate to say, I am your God that created the world. It seems to me like a much bigger miracle than to take me out of Egypt. How come the going out of Egypt is attached to the first commandment? So obviously the going out of Egypt is a huge, huge miracle, and up until today we're mentioning it. But part of the miracle of Yetziat Mitzrayim, of going out of Mitzrayim, is the splitting of the sea. So we have to understand what's behind the splitting of the sea. Now, just to understand exactly what happened, on the 15th day of Nisan, early in the morning, they're all leaving Mitzrayim. Just imagine the butterflies in their stomach. They're in Mitzrayim for 210 years of slavery, 86 years of severe slavery. Just imagine, 86 years, what they went through. You know, we relate with something that's close to us, the Holocaust. They had an 86-year Holocaust. Suddenly, can you imagine the day that they're all leaving? I can't even imagine the excitement. So the 15th day of Nisan, early in the morning, they're going out of Mitzrayim. Wow! What an event! Now, they see the first miracle. They had a cloud, that the cloud was leading them like a GPS. Just imagine 3 million people going out of Mitzrayim. It's not 500 people going on a train. 3 million people are walking out of a country, walking with kids and cattle and wagons, and just imagine the how it looks. And in the front is a cloud, and the cloud is taking them like a GPS, and it's taking them into the desert, deep into the desert. And like I said, it's taking them south into, now they don't know where they are, they're just following the cloud, but the cloud is taking them south. If you're looking at the map, you'll see they're going the wrong way. Now, how was the order? They left Mitzrayim, the 15th day of Nisan was a Thursday. So they leave Thursday morning, and the story says that Thursday morning they leave, Thursday afternoon they park. And they park in a place called Sukkot. This is all written in the Torah. It's not that it's coming from some mystical explanation. This is written in the Torah very clearly, their path. Thursday they leave Mitzrayim, Thursday afternoon they park in a place called Sukkot. Friday they continue going, and it's before Shabbat. Hashem will not lead them on Shabbat in the desert. They stop in another place called Eitan, and that's where they parked for Shabbat. Sunday, they're making their U-turn, which means it's already the fourth day after leaving Mitzrayim. Now they don't know what's going on. They didn't figure that out yet. They're just excited that they went out of Mitzrayim. But on the fourth day, on a Sunday, they're making a U-turn. Now starts asking questions. Whoa, 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 why are we turning? That doesn't look good. So you just imagine, they didn't have WhatsApp. They didn't have SMS messages. So one talk tells the other like a chain. So the head makes a U-turn. Now the message starts going around. We're making a U-turn. We're making a U-turn. We're making a U-turn. It's just going like a cars of a train. And everybody's like, why are we making a U-turn? What was going on? And they make a U-turn. And where do they come? They come to a place that is called Pi HaChirut. Pi is the mouth, and Chirut is freedom. The mouth of freedom, so to say. The edge, so to say. Now, the way that the Torah is calling it, it's calling it as in a different name, call it Pitom V'Ramses. If you remember in the beginning when we talked about the slavery, two parashot ago, it says that we build two cities to Paro. One city was called Pitom and one other city was called Ramses. The myth is, people think that we, as the nations of Israel, built the pyramids. We didn't build the pyramids. We didn't build that. We built these cities. And the Gemara, the Talmud says that everything that the Jews built sunk into the ground. They built, went straight into the ground. Everything that you see, what the archaeologists are finding, we didn't build that. It's not what we built. And specifically not the pyramids. So, and everybody thinks that we built the pyramids. But nevertheless, we built these two cities and they were called Pitom and Ramses. Now Pitom was a tower of rocks. And in this place, we said the Pi HaChirut, the water was in one side. On one side was this rocks that we're talking about. And there were these two huge rocks that are very, very, they were smooth. So you can't climb on them. But these two massive rocks, that was on the right side. And on the left side was a tower that the Egyptians built like a watchtower to make sure nobody's running. And this place was called Migdol. And again, this is all written in the Parasha. All you need to do is open the Parasha and you'll read it. You'll see very clear that they came to the end of the water. Like I said, it's called Pi HaChirut, the mouth of freedom. On the right side was these two huge rocks. There was nowhere of walking. Not rocks like a stone. Like a cliff. A huge, huge rocks. And the size that, you know, nobody could climb over them. It was like a... not a pit, but how do you call it? You see it a lot in the deserts. If you go like in America in the Grand Canyon, you're walking in the canyon and the rock is like 300-400 meters high. You can't climb it. You're stuck in the valley, so to say. But it's not really a valley because it's like a rock. Don't imagine these little rocks that somebody placed there. Imagine like a Grand Canyon that there's no way of climbing up. So one side is the water. One side is that cliff. I can't even climb it. On the other side is this massive tower that the Egyptians build to use as a watchtower to see who's running away. And then in the back, the Egyptians. So they're literally boxed in. They can't go anywhere. So now... The what they built on the left, this tower, it's called Baal Tzafon, and the Midrash says it was a statue. It wasn't like a tower how we relate to, rather it was a statue. The Zohar says that they had these statues as idols, and these idols used to, so to say, snitch when somebody was running away. The idols would be like, hey, he's running away. I mean, there's a question, how would the slaves not able to run away from Mitzrayim? So they had these idols that they were giving them over. So this left tower was this huge statue, and it would like a guard that nobody's running away. Now, why specifically this U-turn? If you remember, the whole time that Moshe is arguing with Paro, he's not telling them we're leaving for good. He's just telling them we're leaving for 3 days. I mean, hopefully you read the parasha last week and the week before. Look at the argument. Moshe Rabbeinu is not telling them we're running away. He just tells us, let us go for 3 days to serve our God, and that's it. And constantly is the argument, who is going? And Moshe is telling him, we're going with our kids, with the elderlies, we're going with our cattle. And then Paro says, okay, just you go without the kids. Moshe says, no, you have to look at the negotiation here. And Paro says, no, I'll let you just the men go. Moshe says, no, we're going with our kids. Paro says, okay, so leave the cattle here. Moshe says, no, we have to take the cattle and the animals with us. That's how we're going to sacrifice. So all this argument, at some point they just leave because there was the plague of the firstborn. Everybody started dying. And Paro got very scared because he's the firstborn. So he says, okay, just leave. After 3 days, they realized, hey, they're not coming back. They left Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. They're already in the very far into the desert. That's when they figured out, wait a minute, they're not coming back. They ran away. Let's go get them. That's the beginning of our parasha. The Paro says, great, get all the chariots. Let's go and catch them. So on the fourth day, Paro is starting to run after them. Then they walk for another 3 days till they get to that place of the ocean. This is Kriyat Yam Suf, is Shvi'i Shel Pesach, on the seventh day. That's when we celebrate on Passover. The first day we do Lel Seder. That's when we left Mitzrayim. And 7 days later, we do what's called Shvi'i Shel Pesach, the seventh day of Pesach. That's when the sea split. So, again, we ask a question. Why the U-turn in the desert? So we know after 3 days, Moshe Paro gets the message. The nation has run away. Let's start running after them. So the Kadosh Baruch Hu is, so to say, making them take a U-turn in order for him to bring them to a point so he can make a miracle. And the miracle, of course, is splitting of the sea. Now, this whole thing that we're talking about is 7 days. On the seventh day, they're already stuck next to the water. Paro is already closing on in the back, and they're coming closer and closer, and now they're stuck. Now, you have to understand, it's not two people running away that you can quickly maneuver. It's moving 3 million people. So, this whole process of 7 days, they're locked into this corner. Now what? Okay, so now we said there are four groups, and each one says something different. Which, in each one of these groups, this opinion, there's something that I can find in myself also. The first group, what did they say? Let's jump into the water. They didn't want to deal with it. How is that relating to me in my life? This is called, in our generation, it's called respect and honor. Sometimes people will do anything just for their honor. I'm not going to do this. Somebody said something against me. I'm going to be fighting him now for 50 years. It's my word, my honor. And that's not a good character trait, that a person can't be, okay, whatever, so I'll put my honor aside right now for peace or for whatever it is. But this is not what we want to talk about. I just want to point out how these four groups, we can find in me also something like that. The next group says, let's go back to Mitzrayim. That's also a very bad character trait. That's giving up. What, every challenge you have, right away you give up? A little bit of a challenge, something comes and throws you off, right away you give up. No, I can't deal with it. This is another bad character trait that we can find in us. And they were, not only that they were willing to give up, they were willing to go back to become slaves. They said, okay, I'd rather be alive than a slave. The other group says, I'd rather be dead and not a slave. And they were like, no, I'll give up. I'd rather go back to my slavery. And if I want to see it in my own life as an attribute, as a character trait of giving up, which is not good. And again, we're not judging anybody. And sometimes the challenge is very hard, and it's very hard not to give up. I'm just making an observation. But what was worse, that they were willing to be slaves. And that's a problem that we have in our life, that I'm willing to be a slave, so to say, quotation marks, than to make a change. And I need to make changes sometimes in my life. And some people say, I'd rather just leave me where I am. Leave me in my discomfort zone. I know it's not good for me, but it's comfortable. I don't want to change too much. Now, of course, comes the third group that says, okay, let's make war. Let's fight with them. Which, again, this is another not such a positive character trait, that sometimes comes a situation or a challenge and you right away want to fight. And that's also not a good thing. Sometimes you can't solve things with fighting. It has to be a different solution than fighting. And, of course, the fourth group said, let's pray. And, okay, you know, they say, I know many people that, needless to say, I'm not going to contradict, praying is powerful. But when there is a challenge, praying is a must, but also has to be an action. You can't just sit and pray all day long. Even though prayer is the most powerful thing to get you out of a situation, but nevertheless, has to be some type of a physical action. We call it a kli, a vessel, that the bracha can come in somehow. I mean, let's say if I'm unemployed, chas v'shalom, I can pray all day long, but if I don't go and look for a job, then how am I going to get a job? So I can pray all day long, and Hashem will answer my prayer, but Hashem will say, in other words, now go look for a job. Write a resume. Apply yourself to something. Maybe learn a trade. So the prayer is powerful, but still has to be an action. Now, Moshe Rabbeinu doesn't know what to do. He's standing there, he's the boss, and everybody's telling him, what should we do? Now he doesn't know what to do. So he turns around himself to Hashem, and he says, Hashem, tell me what to say here. I don't know what to say here. So Hashem answers him in one verse. And the verse, he answers back to the nation. So for the ones who want to fall to jump into the water, the verse says, this is what it says in the parasha, Hityatzvu hayom uru et yeshuat Hashem. Stand firm. No, there's not going to be any jumping into the water today. Stand firm, and you're going to see how Hashem is coming to your rescue. For the ones who wanted to go back to Mitzrayim, the verse says, Lo tosifun lo lirot ot Mitzrayim. You're never going to see Mitzrayim ever again. Don't even take that even as a consideration. This is not happening. You're never going to see Mitzrayim ever again. The ones who said, let's have a fight, the answer was, Hashem yilachem lachem. Hashem is going to fight for you. And the ones who wanted to pray, the verse says, Vatem tacharishon. You keep it quiet. So in one verse, Hashem answered all the four opinions. Which again, when I want to apply it into my life, when I want to jump into the water and to give up, then Hashem tells you, no. Stand, you'll see how Hashem is in control here, not you. The ones who wanted to go back and give up, the answer was also, don't worry, you don't need to go to that place again, to this dark place of Egypt. The ones who wanted to fight, then in my life where I'm fighting, the answer is, don't think you can fight. Hashem fights your fights. You don't do anything. And of course, when it's time to pray, you need to know when it's time to pray and when it's time to not pray, to basically saying, in other words, to shut up. There is an interesting question. All the three answers make sense. One answer doesn't make sense with regards to the fight. What's wrong with fighting? We see our entire history be fighting. So I understand the first two answers and the last one. I understand. Makes sense. When it's time to pray, let's pray. When it's time not to pray, don't pray. Don't give up. I understand. All these I make sure. But the third one with the fighting, that doesn't make sense. What's wrong with fighting? I have an enemy coming to kill me. Go and fight. And for the last 3,000 years, we see we were involved in many, many fights. Starting from the desert, we fought seven nations. Then when we went into Eretz Israel, we fought the nations. All the time, there's fights. The last 70 years, where this entire nation is in a fight. What's wrong with fighting? The Chatam Sofer gives a very interesting commentary why this specific answer was applied, because the Chatam Sofer says Am Israel owed a favor to the Egyptians, because when Yaakov came to Mitzrayim, they treated him nice. They gave him a land, and it's not only him, it's him and all the tribes. And they gave him a land, the land that is called Goshen, and they treated him nice, and they gave him respect. So the Chatam Sofer says, once somebody helps you, doesn't matter later on, they become mean, or they go against you. One time they helped you, you can't fight with them. You're not allowed to do that. So the Chatam Sofer explains why we were not allowed to fight with them. Because it only takes it one time for a nation or a person to help you, then you're not allowed to fight with them. You have to give them the same measure that they were good with you once. That's it. and Hashem will fight for you. This in itself is a lesson for us to take, because we find many situations in my life that somebody does something to me and I want to fight them. And I will either fight them with the answering back, or physically, or lawsuit, legally, or with my mouth, I'll go and talk Lashon Hara about them, whatever it is. It's very easy when somebody attacks me to fight back in many different ways. The Torah comes and tells you, don't ever fight back. It's Hashem's fight. When you fight back, then you go down to that level. If you let Hashem do your fight, then he will be victorious. When you take the matters to your own hands, there's a chance you'll lose. Let Hashem do the fights for you. Especially if it's a person that once did something good to you. Then you have to hold that as a credit and say, okay, one time you did something good to me, I can't fight with you. I'm going to leave Hashem. Hashem will do the fighting for you. This is the opinion of the Chatam Sofer. So now back to our question again. So why do we need this whole miracle? Again, we had these questions last week. Why do we need 10 plagues? Isn't it enough just to go like that and to make Paro disappear? So we explained why we needed 10 plagues. Now we come to the same question. Why do we need the miracle of splitting the ocean? We already saw that Hashem is great. So we know that Hashem never changes nature. Hashem created the nature in a certain way. And any miracle that Hashem will do will be in nature. Hashem doesn't add something new. And there are thousands of miracles throughout the years. But if you follow the order, you will see that Hashem always uses nature. He maybe manipulates the nature, but he doesn't change nature. He doesn't add something new that never existed. So when it came to the plagues, okay, so he took a lot of blood and he put it in the water. He didn't create anything new. And with the frogs, okay, there's frogs now too. He just made millions of them. And they were very big. And then when it came to the mixture of bad animals, he didn't create new animals. He just got a lot of bears and wolves and tigers and lions together, and they're all running in the street. So go through all the plagues, and any miracle you see in our history, it's still nature, just so to say, using the nature. Hashem doesn't change the creation, and definitely not the rules of the nature. So, okay, that raises a new question. Why did Hashem have to punish Paro? Didn't he punish him enough? I mean, not that I'm taking Paro's side. All I care, you can continue punishing him. But I'm just asking a logical question. Why Paro got punished already with all these plagues? The whole country went down to the toilet. I mean, there was nothing left of Mitzrayim. Why do you need to punish him even more? So the answer is, Hashem says no. Hashem brought him to the water to punish him in the water, specifically. Not in the plagues, the punishment had to be in the water. Now, when we're asking the question, why did Hashem had to take them 7 days like this and like that into the desert? Hashem wanted already to prepare them to going into Eretz Israel. They were slaves, they were broken, they were weak, they were sad, they didn't have any energy even. You ever saw these videos that they're showing, that they come out now, they show all these videos about Hashem Yerachem, the Holocaust survivors going out of the camps? They're all like skeletons. They're barely walking. There's a video in the release not too long ago that one of the American units, when they came into one of the camps, and they're releasing them. And they're walking in, they're like, they're all throwing up, they're all the soldiers, they can't even believe. But they're walking out of there like skeletons, they can't even, somebody has to carry them. You think it was different when they came out of Mitzrayim? You think they were just walking out of Mitzrayim like singing? They were half dead, being there for 210 years of slavery. So Hashem needed to start building them up. Now, not only that physically they were broken, mentally and emotionally they were broken. Mothers losing their kids, fathers losing their kids. I mean, just imagine what was going on in their mind. So Hashem needed to strengthen them, to build them, and especially when they were going into Eretz Israel. There is going to be a war. They're going to be walking in the desert. Kadosh Baruch Hu wanted to prepare them. Now, originally, don't forget that originally they were supposed to be in the desert, going towards Har Sinai, getting the Torah and going into Eretz Israel. The fact that they were got stuck in the desert for 40 years, that was a mistake. That wasn't a plan. They were supposed to literally go out of Mitzrayim, Har Sinai, get the Torah, go into Eretz Israel. They went out of Mitzrayim on the 15th day of Nisan, and on the 15th day of Av, they were supposed to build the Beit HaMikdash in Eretz Israel. So we're talking about from Nisan, the entire, from Nisan to Iyar, then Sivan, Tammuz, Av, 4 months. The whole thing was supposed to be 4 months, and on the 15th day of Av, they were supposed to be ready with Beit HaMikdash in Eretz Israel. So Hashem says, how are they going to build the land? They're going to have to, look how the Jews came to the land of Israel in 1947, 48, well, look at what they built. It took 10, 20 years. They started building. There was all swamps here when they came. There was nothing here. And they came here with a lot of hope and coming out of the ashes and build a country, build a nation. Same thing then. Hashem says they have to build Eretz Israel. How are they going to build them? I have to start preparing them. So Hashem says, I'm going to take them in the desert. So again, brings the same question. So why did Paro have to be punished again? Technically, one can say he got punished in the Ten Commandments. He should be punished again. Why should he be punished again? So, again, we understand that Hashem wanted to bring Paro into to the water. He wanted to bring him to the ocean in order to teach him. Now, specifically, Hashem wanted to make them walk in the desert because the desert has a very special character trait. That the desert, you can't be spoiled. If you go now to the desert, you don't have your comfort. When you're going to a beautiful hotel, some people, their choice of a vacation is to go to a nice resort, when they walk up in the morning and there's a breakfast buffet, and then in the afternoon they have a lunch served, and they sit in the pool, and that's the vacation they like. And some people will go on a cruise, or, you know, some people, they go on hikes, they go camping. They get dressed in dirty clothes, and they go and walk in the desert or in a forest, and that's their vacation. But one can definitely agree that in a desert, you can't be spoiled. There's no conditions in the desert. There's no air conditioning. There's no beds. This is hard conditions in the desert. The Rambam explains that specifically that when a person is in the desert, you know what it develops when a person is in a place like a desert? It develops bravery because you have to deal now with what's going on in the desert. There's animals, there's danger. It builds courage because you have to now battle with what's going on in the desert, and it also builds determination. Put now a person in a hard situation, it makes them a much stronger person. You know, when I came to the United States, I lived in America for 18 years. And I came to the United States when I was 23. And this is just an observation, it's not to talk Lashon Hara about anybody, but the first thing that I noticed, especially in the men, I was like, they're very immature, very soft and immature men. And I was, that was the first time that I appreciated the fact that I was in the army. I mean, I didn't want to go to the army. I mean, but that's, you know, you in Israel, you grow already with the mind frame that you are going to be in the army. So when I was already 15, 16, I was already becoming excited to go to the army. I wanted to have the gun. I wanted to be in the army. So, but the army is very, very hard. Puts you into a lot of hard situations. But the first time that I appreciated when I met a different nation, and I was like, when I was 18, I was in Lebanon, bullets flying over my head when my another side of the world, an 18-year-old boy is in college drinking beer and going to fraternity parties. So I was like, you know, it makes you a completely different human being. And I met men in my age or even older, and I said, you know, they're nice guys, but they're very immature, extremely immature, and not only that, they're soft. They're soft. They don't know how to deal with stress, with situations, because the army puts you in the middle of the desert. Now survive. So you learn how to survive. You learn how to become a man of resources. You become a machine, so to say. So interestingly, Maimonides, Rambam, also says that, you know, the desert has good qualities, because the desert, A, builds in you courage and determination and bravery. So Rambam says, I understand why he took them in the desert. He needed to give them some, to build them up. Can you imagine being oppressed for so, can you, if you don't mind, the speaking is very disturbing in the back. There's many rooms here, you can sit in the back and chat, and we have coffee and cookies. And so Maimonides says that he needed to build their confidence. They were slaves for so long, they had zero confidence. How are they going to go into the land of Israel? How are they going to build a nation? How are they going to do everything? So specifically, Hashem said, Maimonides explains that he took them into the desert. And he says, okay, now camp out a little bit. Build some strength. Be a little bit rough. Yeah, you know, life is not easy. And you know what? I see with many situations, and again, it's not to chas v'shalom put somebody down, but I see, an observation. And of course, you can say many bad things about the Israelis. They might be, you know, loud and vulgar and violent or whatever it is. There's a lot of things you can say negative about the Israelis. But if you want to be positive and lelamed zchut, look at the, you know, they're very serious. And they take things and matters into their hands. And they know how to deal with things quick. And it's all different. And again, it's very easy to look to say on anybody bad things and good things. We're now trying just to make some observations. And I definitely attribute a lot of that to the fact that Israeli teenagers, women and men, go to the army. It shapes them up, makes them completely a total different human being. You know, now we made Aliyah 2 years ago. I have boys, young boys. One of my boys, he wants to go to the army. He's very excited. He's like, I want to go to the army. Another boy says, no, I'm afraid. I don't want to go to. Obviously, my answer to them, you're so young, if we're going to need an army in 9 years, oy vavoy, if we're still not going to have Mashiach in 9 years, then we're going to still need an army. So, but nevertheless, I constantly tell them, if you reach to the age and you decide not to sit and learn Torah, and you want to go to the army, I'll support that. There's nothing wrong with that. If you're sitting and learning Torah, go ahead. I will support that. But you have to sit and learn Torah. Not pretend that you're learning Torah. But if you don't want to learn Torah, then go to the army. He's going to make a man of you. So, and again, I'm not now giving now a political view of what I think is going on now in Israel with this whole argument with the army. I can tell you that that a lot of it is wrong. Because the majority of the students don't really learn. It's a lot of politics here, and a lot of power, and unfortunately a lot of corruption, because many of the heads of the yeshivot are corrupt, and they're getting millions of dollars, and millions. It's not like they're getting a lot of money per student, donations and from the government, and a lot of these yeshivas, they say we have 1,000 students, and really they only have 200 students, and they're getting money for that. It's corrupt. And they're telling the young guys, go and protest in the name of the Torah. And it's not right. So again, I'm not giving now a political opinion here. I'm just saying what's going on. So I'm not taking a stand, not from here and not from here. Because if a person is learning Torah, then leave him and learn Torah. There's enough strong men that can go to the army. We were laughing when I was in the army, that I was always laughing at the yeshiva bachers. They can be in the army. They're all pale and skinny, and that can be a fighter. I'm from the age of 4 jumping up and down, and I'm in good physical shape. Sometimes we would see these boys coming from the yeshiva. They don't even know how to kick a ball. They're pale from the fluorescent light. They're learning Torah from morning to night, which again, we need them too. But that's not material for the army. Your army, you need to be rough, you need to be strong, you need to be brave. So, but nevertheless, a lot of the men, they reach to the age of 18, if they're really going to sin, learn Torah, sin, learn Torah. Leave them alone. Don't touch them. Don't take them into the army. We need them as learning Torah. But the ones that are sitting outside and smoking, take them to the Torah. And you know what? It's about 70-80% of the ones who claim that they learn Torah to get out of the army, they're not really learning. They're sitting outside, they're smoking, they're getting in trouble, they're going out, they're having fun. So these ones you can definitely take to the army, make a mensch out of them. So, but nevertheless, I do appreciate the time that I was in the army, as hard as it was. It made me, you know, build a lot of my character. The army teaches you how to deal with things, how to be brave, how to, you know, when you're 18 years old and you get a gun and go fight, it makes you a completely different type of looking, completely different at the world. Gives you a sense of responsibility, a sense of caring for your platoon mates. I don't know how you call it in English, but your friends to the platoon. You learn the value of a human life, and I think it's a very, very powerful lesson to your life. So the same thing, Maimonides says the same thing. Hashem took them into the desert. They need to learn. For 210 years, they were slaves. They were weak. Hashem wanted to build them. Now we have to understand again. So what's the miracle of the ocean? Okay, yeah, you explained to me now they went through the desert. Good. Now why they had to split the ocean? Now, if you really pay attention to the parasha last week and the week before, look at the argument between Moshe Rabbeinu and Paro. There was an argument. There was a backwards and forth argument. What was the argument really about? Whether there is or isn't a God. That's the argument. Now, the Kadosh Baruch Hu says, Moshe goes into Mitzrayim and he says to Paro, let my people go. Paro says, who said so? Moshe says, God said so. Paro says, who? I never heard of such a thing. I don't know God. So the argument was between Moshe and Paro, not necessarily about taking the Jews out of Mitzrayim or not. Rather, if there is a God or if there's not a God. Now, the funny thing is that Moshe Rabbeinu goes to Paro and he tells him, let my people go. Paro says, are you joking? Moshe Rabbeinu says, no, I'm not. So Paro says, who are you that I should let my slaves go? Moshe Rabbeinu says, it's not me, I'm a messenger. God says so. Paro says, God? Who is this God? So Moshe tells to him, it's the God of the world. So Paro says, I never met him. So Moshe answers him, no, only I talk to him. Oh, really? You really sound very credible. You're coming into me and you're telling me you are the only one who speaks with this invisible God, and you want me to send now my slaves out? How ridiculous does that sound? Come and so Moshe Rabbeinu says, okay, let me prove to you that it's God that sent me. So he throws the staff on the floor, turns it into a serpent. Paro says, are you joking? I also have magicians that can do that. So he brings his magicians and they do the same thing. And then Moshe Rabbeinu, the first three plagues that Moshe does, Paro says, my sorcerers can do that too. What are you? Are you out of your mind? It's the fourth plague already with the lice. That's when the sorcerer says, okay, that we can't do. That's already the hand of God. But just imagine how ridiculous the argument is in the beginning. And Moshe Rabbeinu tells you, the God that nobody can see, I talk to him. He only talks to me. So, of course, the miracles don't convince Paro. He says, what are you talking about? Were you some type of a clown? You're coming to make a joke out of me? Everything that you're telling me, I do the same thing. Only later on, the plagues started becoming worse and worse and worse. That's when Paro is starting to get a little bit more convinced. But up until the last plague, Paro is still not convinced. And he says, why should I listen to your God? So Moshe says, okay, if you won't listen to my God, I'm going to have to take you to the ocean. I'm going to have to show you who's God. And the only place to do it is in the ocean. Now, why specifically the ocean? Because the same way that the ocean covers an entire world, you know, they say that whatever's in the world above, you can find it in the ocean. And really the ocean is much greater than what we see above the ocean. I mean, the ground, the continents, the land is much, much smaller than the quantity of the size of the oceans. and even the depth of the oceans. Take the highest mountain in the world, turn it upside down into the ocean, the depth, the ocean is 10 times more deeper. So obviously the ocean is much, much greater than what the revealed is. So the ocean has a very unique character trait that it covers everything that's in it. Stand now on a ship, look down in the ocean, you can't see anything. You just see the surface of the water. Go down now and start scuba diving, you'll start seeing what's going on. But if you go into mamash, in the middle of the ocean, even if you scuba dive, what are you going to see? A bunch of water. Once in a blue moon, you'll see a fish. Sometimes you're snorkeling in some reef. So the ocean covers the entire world that is under the ocean. And that's why Moshe wanted to bring Paro to the ocean, because the ocean, the water, represents hidden and complete worlds that you can't see. And the same way that the ocean covers on the world below, the nature of the world is covering the godly revelation in this world. I don't see now a godly revelation. I never saw a godly revelation. Neither one of you saw a godly revelation. We see nature. I see trees, and I see the sky, and I see the ocean, and I see animals, and I see everything. I don't see God here. A prophet can see God, but we can't. And the same way that the ocean covers and what's inside the ocean, the nature covers the world. And I don't see any godly revelation. Same idea. Now, the Midrash explains that Moshe Rabbeinu, when he came first time to Mitzrayim, it was Paro's birthday. Moshe and Aaron, they come into Mitzrayim, and they want to talk to Paro. Now, specifically, the Midrash says it was Paro's birthday. Therefore, everything was open. The palace was open. Everybody was able to walk in. Because why? They had a big birthday party. And all the ministers of all the nations, kings and princesses and ministers and from all over the nations, they all came to the party. So the palace was completely open. So the same thing, Moshe and Aaron also walk in. Just they all waltz into the palace. And at some point they get stopped. And the guards are asking them, who are you? They said, we came to meet Paro. Okay, what are your names? We'll go and ask. They take the names, they go into Paro, and they said, there's some two guys out here. They're two old guys are coming with, you know, with suspenses, you know, with the shlekes. You know, just imagine Moshe and Aaron, these two old guys in their 80s, walking in. They just walked into the palace. The guards stop them, and they say, who are you? Said, we came to talk to Moshe Rabbeinu, to Paro. Then they walk into the guards, walk into Paro, and they say, listen, there's these two guys here, these two old guys, and they want to talk to you. So Paro tells them, did they bring any presents? Because all the ministers, everybody came with some type of a present. You're going to meet Paro. It was the king of the world, Mr. Trump. So he says, these old guys, they brought presents? No, they didn't bring any presents. So Paro says, no. So they say, kick them out. Anyways, Paro and Aaron somehow got in and then started the whole argument. And Moshe's telling them, let my people go. And he tells them, why should I let you go? He says, but because God told me to let you, to tell you. He says, I don't know any God here. That's where it all started. So the argument between Moshe and Paro was whether is a God or not. Because Moshe kept coming with all these plagues, with all these miracles. And Paro was like, no, I don't believe. Especially the beginning. But even later, Paro saw and he didn't want to believe. So the argument here was not about letting the nation go or not. Is whether is a God or not. So the splitting of the ocean was the revelation of hidden powers. Because there is hidden powers, there's godly powers that we don't see, they're not revealed. And the splitting of the ocean was the revelation, so to say, of these hidden powers. And it says that when the oceans got split, also the heavens got split. It wasn't just the ocean, everything opened. And this godly revelation appeared to everybody. It says that what they saw in the splitting on the ocean, that it wasn't a normal scene. It wasn't just that the water just opened. It was an unbelievable miracle. It's like as if the cover of the world disappeared and everybody saw this godly revelation. It says what a maidservant saw on the ocean, the prophet Yechezkel didn't even see. It's like as if Hashem removed some type of a layer that covers this godly revelation, and everybody saw that. And it says, you know, we read every day when we pray Shacharit, we read the part, the singing of the sea, Shirat Hayam. This Shabbat, Bezrat Hashem, we're going to sing it. It's a very special parasha. But it says that in Shirat Hayam, there's a certain verse that we read. It says, Ze keli ve'anveo. And it's a very not so clear verse, because what it means, Ze, it means that. Keli, my God, ve'anveo. I recognize this. What do you mean you recognize this? How do you recognize that? The word Ze means that they saw. They actually saw God. Now, the Midrash says, why would they say something like this? Why would you point at something that says that? It's that. You know, like you bring a bunch of people to a lineup, and the witness says, that one. You recognize it. The Midrash says that the women couldn't have babies so easily, because right away the guards will come and throw the babies into the water. So they used to run away to the fields, to whatever it is, just to have the baby, that the baby is not going to be taken. The Midrash says that angels came to take the babies and they raised the babies. I mean, how did we multiply to become 15 million? I mean, we made a very rough estimate how many people were in Egypt. If 3 million came out, means that in Egypt it was 15 million, because only 20% came out, which means 80% stayed in Mitzrayim. That's 12 million. 12 million, that's a lot of people. So obviously, not all the babies were thrown into the water. The Midrash says that the angels used to take the babies and used to raise them and take care of them. Now, the babies became kids and teenagers, and when they walked through the ocean, they recognize, hey, these are the angels that took care of us. The ones who raised us. So when they were pointing and saying, that's God. Now we recognize God. So the miracle that happened on the splitting of the sea, it's not only water standing up and they're going through the water. It was way more than that. A whole level, a whole revelation was appearing, that everybody saw a godly revelation. Just imagine what's going on there. Now, interestingly, comes another question. Why specifically it was Moshe, that the name Moshe that we're using? You know, Moshe is the name that the daughter of Paro gave him. It's not his real name. Because when Moshe Rabbeinu was born, 3 months he was by his parents, by Yocheved and Amram. Now they named him. Now he didn't have to go through a circumcision because he was born circumcised, but there was still the ceremony of the Brit, and obviously they named him. He has other names. The Midrash says that Moshe Rabbeinu has 10 names. But one of the first names that the Torah mentions that Moshe Rabbeinu has, his name is Yekutiel. Moshe Rabbeinu is the non-Jewish name that he got by the daughter of Paro. It's like now in America, you meet people, what's your name? They tell you an American name and also a Jewish name. So they have an American name for the job or whatever it is, and then a Jewish name, what the parents gave him. So Moshe Rabbeinu also had a Jewish name. Not that Moshe is not, I mean, up until today we're using it. But obviously the name Moshe wasn't the original name. Why is that name is the one that is being used all the time and not the other names? So Moshe means min hamayim meshitihu. I have pulled him out of the water. That's what it means. And the water, they symbolize the spiritual world. That's why we use constantly the name Moshe Rabbeinu, because Moshe Rabbeinu is presenting the spiritual world. Now, there is a beautiful commentary by Maimonides, by Rambam, and also another commentary called Abarbanel, that the splitting of the sea, like I said before, was to build the strength and the emunah and the bitachon in the Kadosh Baruch Hu. Because they came out of Mitzrayim, they were completely broken. So why specifically Moshe Rabbeinu brought Paro into the ocean? Because we mentioned the ocean reveals the, in the ocean, so to say, it reveals the hidden worlds. The worlds that we are wondering about, that we don't know anything about them, but they're hidden worlds. And we just don't see it. Now, that's why the Kadosh, why Moshe Rabbeinu brought Paro into the to the ocean. Because when the ocean split, everybody saw it. Not only the Bnei Israel, the nation of Israel, that went through the ocean. Everybody who came there saw the miracle. Now, Moshe Rabbeinu, his argument, I told you, whether there is or isn't a God. Since Moshe Rabbeinu was not able to convince Paro with the plagues, so he says, okay, let me bring you to the water. That's when you're really going to see that there's a God. So he did whatever he could. That's why Hashem allowed this to happen, to bring Paro. Paro is the klipa. Paro is the manifestation of the Yetzer Hara. And that also had to be proven that there's a power that is above you. So that's the explanation specifically why they had to bring the Paro into the ocean. So Paro himself will see. You know, Paro didn't drown. Everybody drowned. Paro didn't drown. He made tshuva, he got washed off to the shore. So he didn't die at the end. But the point was to bring Paro, who was the ultimate Yetzer Hara, to become to annulify himself in front of Hashem by recognizing the power that is above me. Now we like seeing how is that all connected to me, because it's all the parasha has to come and teach me something. So we have the same arguments all day long between me and myself. Is there a God or there isn't a God? Now when everything goes very smooth, then the God is the best God. And I believe in him. But when there's a challenge, suddenly I don't believe in God anymore. Or I don't want to. Or it's hard for me to believe in God. And we go through this struggle every day. Is there a God or there isn't a God? And like I said, when everything is going very smooth, then there is a God and he's great. But when something that's working out very well, so I come to question Hashem, why are you doing this to me? Why are you leaving me? Why are you letting me suffer? Why are you throwing me now to in the struggle? And suddenly I lose my faith in God. Suddenly there isn't a God. Now comes the struggle and it will develop the argument between me and myself. Should I jump into the water, like the first group that said, or should I go back to Mitzrayim? Should I go back to my state of limitation? Now, if I'm jumping into the water, what does it represent? I'm going back into the holy side. I'm going into Kedusha. That I say, no, I trust Hashem. The challenge will disappear. The whatever's going on here, Hashem is going to take care of me. And I jump into the ocean. I said, no, I'm going into the world of holiness. There is a God. And you know what? That's when the challenge disappears. The second they jumped into the water, whoop, the water opened. Or what is my other option? Is to go back to Mitzrayim. When I go back to Mitzrayim, I'm choosing the physical route, the Gashmiut. Then I'm saying, I do not trust Hashem. Hashem cannot come to my aid. I have to do something. And I'm choosing to go back to Mitzrayim. I'm choosing to go to a state of limitation that I think that I am in charge of anything here. And I will be able to turn the wheels here. And that's the going back to Mitzrayim. That I don't choose that it's Hashem that is in charge and He's going to take care of everything. Rather, I say, no, everything is in my hands. Now, this is a struggle that I have daily. I have to understand that I need both. I can't just jump into the ocean. I can't just admit myself to a yeshiva and learn Torah all day long from morning to night and just say, Hashem somehow will bring me food to my table. I'm not allowed to do that. I'm not allowed to count on a miracle. I'm not allowed to sit and learn Torah all day long and say, you know what, I'm going to be like Rabbi Hanina ben Dosa. Rabbi Hanina ben Dosa would sit and learn all day long, and food would say, that says about Rabbi Hanina ben Dosa, he was such a tzaddik, the sky would open, the ceiling would open, and food would come down on his table. I'm not Rabbi Hanina ben Dosa. So I have to include myself in the physical world. So I can't jump to one extreme and say I'm only going to learn Torah and somehow Hashem is going to take care of business. But I can't come and say, no, Hashem has zero ability. I have to do everything. I have to find a very equal middle that I have to be immersed in Kedusha, learn Torah, pray, do mitzvot, trust in Hashem, but still do something physical. Still do apply a physical act. And yes, I do have to go and work. And yes, I do have to go and learn a trade so I'll have what to do. And I have to do something. But to know that it's equal, together. It has to be together. I can't just go to one side or the other side. And that's why the whole idea of the splitting of the sea is to teach me that yes, I am going to be thrown into this world, which is like a desert. Because Hashem wants me to be stronger. He wants me to deal with things. He wants me to rise above my problems, above my challenges, and apply it in this world. So the whole point of the splitting of the sea is to teach me that yes, you are going to be walking in the desert. But you have to have the utmost respect and trust into Hashem that He's going to be the one who's leading you in. And He's the one who's going to save you. He's the one who's going to sustain you. He's the one who's going to nourish you. But you cannot just jump into the water. It has to have a very equal balance. And that's the right way to walk towards Mount Sinai where I'm getting the Torah. That in my life too, we're also walking towards Mount Sinai. Maybe we already got the Torah 3,400 years ago, but we're going to get it very soon again, the additional part, when Mashiach comes. So that I'm also constantly climbing towards Har Sinai. But mainly I want to take from that practically. I like taking practical things from the Parasha into my life, not to just live in some in a historical event. Is to understand that I have to have a very, very equal path, that I can't take extreme just to the Gashmiut and say, no, I don't believe in Hashem. And that usually only will come to a test when there's a challenge. When everything is going great, then there's no problems, there's no complaints. Hashem is the best. The problems start with my belief is when things don't work out. And it's not because you did something bad. A lot of people think that something bad happens to you or a challenge because you did something bad. And I don't like the people that come and say, oh, this is happening to you because you did this and that. Who are you to tell me that? Some people come and says, oh, you lost your job because you were mean to that person or you... But now becoming the messenger of Hashem that tells you what's happening to who because of what? Nobody can know that. You can maybe assume. You can maybe say, okay, you know, when something bad happens, it should raise your thoughts. Maybe because I did hear something wrong, then Hashem is showing it to me here. But I can't say 100%, oh, this is happening because of that. Nobody is allowed to do such a thing. And yes, I do need to take signs from something bad that happened to me that maybe I've done something. But sometimes I challenge that I go through, it's not because I did something and Hashem is punishing me. No, because there's just a challenge. And Hashem wants to see if I will still believe in Him. And Hashem wants to see if I will still have trust in Him. And if I will still believe in the Torah. And I will still fulfill the mitzvot. Because usually when there's a challenge, I don't feel it being so observant. That's usually the case. When everything is going smooth, I'll be the first one in the minyan to pray. I'll be the first one to give charity. I'll be the first one to do everything. Now there's a challenge, whether it's financial, whether it's health, whether it's relationships, suddenly you're like, ugh, I don't feel like praying right now. I don't feel like doing a mitzvah right now. All my excitement for the mitzvot, they go out like the wind. So the Torah comes and teach me, yes, you will have a lot of challenges in your life. And the challenge to go over the challenge is like splitting the sea. You can't just jump off or past the challenge like that. But there's something hidden behind it. There's spiritual worlds, there's godly powers that we're not aware of them. And we just have to know that Hashem is constantly around us and there's a reason for everything. I just have to find a very good balance in between. That my life is full of holiness, that I pray three times a day and I eat kosher and I observe Shabbat and everything, whatever the Torah tells me. But I can't just depend just on that and live in some la-la land. I need to have my feet on the ground and to know that no, Hashem helps the ones who help themselves. I have to initiate things. That's why the whole journey in the desert. Hashem says, I want you to be independent. I don't want you to be spoiled and screaming to you all day long. Yeah, become independent. So learn to survive and learn to develop things by yourself and then learn to have responsibility. And that's what Hashem is telling us. What do you think? I'm going to come and save you. There's no question here. But Hashem wants us to become more responsible and mature, specifically to be able to merge the physical and the spiritual together. If I'm going to extreme to neither one of the sides, it's not healthy. I have to know how to take the physical and the spiritual and merge them together. That's how I really go out of my own Mitzrayim, which is my own limitation. That's what we want to take from this week's parasha and apply it to our week. And I can guarantee to you that when you learn how to do that in the best way possible, you'll see that your life is constantly ascending and ascending, and your spiritual level just grows and grows. And yes, challenges will happen till the last day of your life. They don't disappear. And you should not necessarily bang yourself on the head all day long because there are challenges, because you did something wrong. No, that's what Hashem wants. Hashem wants me to grow. And there's going to be a challenge after a challenge and another challenge. And even when you're in your 80s, there's problems. So just take a deep breath. Say, Baruch Hashem, challenges are good, makes me stronger. And Hashem, you know, when you believe in Hashem and you Hashem sees that you apply your action with being responsible and mature, and then Hashem says, now I'll come and help you. When you're becoming spoiled and a brat and saying no and whining, then Hashem says, okay, so go figure it out by yourself. Bezat Hashem, we should marry to cross our own sea, go out of our own Mitzrayim, and marry to see the receiving of the additional part of the Torah very soon with the coming of Mashiach. Have a beautiful rest of the week.